Hello everyone, I'm Dimple Rangila and today we're going to talk about early education of tribal children using their socio-cultural contexts and materials. The Indian Constitution identifies for special consideration certain ethnic minority groups traditionally referred to as tribes or tribals as scheduled tribes who constitute around 8% of the total population of the country. There are 573 scheduled tribes living in different parts of the country. Most of the tribal communities have their own languages, different from the languages spoken in the state where they are located. There are more than 270 such languages. The National Policy on Education in 1986 specified among the following: priority will be accorded to opening primary schools in tribal areas. There is need to develop curricula and devise instructional material in tribal language at the initial stages with arrangements for switch over to the regional languages once the child is fairly comfortable with the mother tongue. Promising scheduled tribal youth will be encouraged to take up teaching in tribal areas because they will be the ones who will relate to the children much more, will know of their language that is spoken at home, and the children will also be relate to them. Ashram schools or residential schools will be established on a large scale in tribal areas. Incentive schemes will be formulated for the scheduled tribes, keeping in view their special needs and the lifestyle that they follow. So, children of the scheduled tribes often face difficulties because of their social, ethnic, economic and cultural differences. So let's look at some of these issues. First is the low literacy rate. The Indian census data reveals that the tribal literacy rate is low, and in case of tribal girls, it is still worse. Low intake and high dropouts. In school enrollment of tribal children is very low in comparison to other groups. And even before completing the elementary education, more than half of the enrolled tribal children drop out of school without completing the elementary school education. We will look at the reasons for why there is a high dropout rate among children who come from the tribal areas. Low levels of comprehension. Generally, this is the one major reason that the school language for them is completely different from the language that they speak at home. So, due to which they find difficulty in understanding the classroom transaction and the language of the textbook. As a result, they exhibit very low levels of listening and reading comprehension because they are not able to understand what is being taught in the classroom. Even if we will be taught something which is totally alien and unknown to us, and even if the simplest of concept is taught, we may not be able to understand. But if the same concept is taught in our language that I know and in the words that I use at home, it will be much more easier for me as well as interesting for me to comprehend the same. And their ability to communicate with others is also not very well developed. If they have teachers who are not able to understand their language, then obviously there will be a communication gap between the teacher and the student. Low achievement levels. Nearly all the achievement surveys conducted so far indicate extremely low levels of achievement of tribal children, and in particular the tribal girls. Tribal children not only score less marks in subject areas but also fail to gain life skills during schooling, and one of the major reasons for this is the same, that the home language is not same for them as the school language in which they are spoken. Experience of failure and low self-esteem. Continuous failure for a long period of time decreases their self-confidence, which further lowers their self-esteem. Continuously demonstrating poor performance, the tribal children lose their self-confidence and hence develop a low self-esteem. And then it leads to what we talked about, the dropping out from schools. Then it is more disadvantageous for girls. Tribal girls at more disadvantage. They have to do household work as well as take care of their younger siblings at home. So in a way, they are double disadvantage. One, for them, since they have to do household chores, take care of the household chores and of the children in the family, the younger siblings, the tribal girl is further double disadvantaged of not getting the school education. Major causes for such poor status of education of tribal children are, first and foremost, is the lack of family awareness and support. Most of the tribal children coming to school are first generation learners. That means in their families, they are the first one to join school. That means none of the elders in their family has ever gone to school. As a result, they are not literate and living in far distant and remote areas. They are totally unaware of the necessity of school education and cannot provide any support to the child in the school. In most cases, they do not show any interest in the child's education. So, a person at home who motivates, encourages the child to go to school, to continue education, to be with them when the child is studying, that support is lacking, especially in case of children from some of the tribal homes. Even those who are now showing interest in their child's education, they do not have adequate educational experience to provide assistance and guidance to their children because they themselves have not been to the school, they are not literate, but they can provide support to their children. Extreme poverty of the family. Extreme poverty of the tribal families is one of the major causes of children not attending school. Although they are being supported with textbooks, school uniforms, reading and writing materials free of cost, and even in residential schools, they get hostel facilities without any payment and rather get some stipend, the families still cannot afford to send their children to schools regularly as some of them are engaged in supplementing the meager income of the family. Further, the girls, as I said earlier also, are engaged in household chores and taking care of the younger sibling. And boys may be doing some other errands, running some errands or doing certain work for the family. And the child is not then spared by parents to go to school. Inaccessibility to schooling facilities. Usually, the tribal habitations are small, scattered, separated by adverse geographical conditions. It is difficult for any child to cross natural barriers to come to the neighborhood school situated within 1 kilometer distance from the habitation as per the government norms. Establishing schools in all such small habitations with hardly 4 to 6 children is not a viable proposition. So they have to travel longer distance. So many a times they are not able to reach out to the schools in certain circumstances, which act as a natural barrier for them. And hence, these places, the schooling in this case, becomes inaccessible for children. Inadequate and irregular teachers, poor communication facilities, presence of natural barriers, and lack of residential facilities makes it even more difficult for any outside teacher to attend the school regularly. Most of the teachers of these schools working in most adverse conditions in the remote tribal areas are quite demotivated and are quite disinterested in doing their job with proper enthusiasm. So this way they are irregular to the school. The same natural barrier which acts as a barrier for children acts for the teacher as well. Plus, if there are no residential facilities and other facilities that are provided to the teacher, it becomes difficult for them. And if they are not intrinsically motivated and enthusiastic about the tasks at hand, then that also serves as a barrier. Less or no use of mother tongue or home language as a medium of instruction. Mother tongue as a medium of instruction plays a vital role to bridge the gap of language learning. A child who has mastery over mother tongue develops other languages easily. A child who first learns at the school also the different concepts and academics in mother tongue can further learn a second language and even more languages and become a multilingual child if the focus is given on the home language. if the teacher is not familiar with the mother tongue of the child, then again that divide and barrier occurs between the child and the teacher. The teacher is not able to understand the child fully, and similarly the child also is not able to form a rapport with the teacher. If early education of the children is based on their mother tongue, the foundation in both language learning and concept learning will be very strong. It has been observed that children learn better from a familiar starting point. So their mother tongue is something that they are familiar with since their birth. So learning will be much better, much easier, and they will retain that. Children learn better through a language they speak and understand well, again, which is the mother tongue in this case. Learning to read and write is easier in a familiar language, and concepts are best understood through their mother tongue. So it is very important that first the child must be taught in his or her mother tongue, and then the second language is to be introduced, because once the mastery over the mother tongue is attained, then it is not difficult for a child to move ahead and learn the unknown language. Second language learning is more successful with a good foundation in the mother tongue. The indigenous knowledge is best learned through indigenous language, that is the language of their own. So cultural knowledge will further be much more added on, it will, if it is used in a way that the language of the child is, or the mother tongue, home language is used. Children with a solid foundation in their mother tongue develop stronger literacy abilities in other languages. Similarly, knowledge and skills learnt through mother tongue are transferred efficiently while learning the second language. So once they are through and much good at the mother tongue, when they are learning the second language, that knowledge is transferred very efficiently. And this kind of learning the child retains for a much longer time. Now let us see what will happen if children are not taught in their mother tongue. When tribal children are not taught in their native language, they seem to be totally disinterested in what the teacher is saying, which is very obvious because they are not understanding what is being taught. So they will lose interest. They stare vacantly at the teacher and sometimes at the blackboard where some alphabets had been written, but those alphabets do not mean anything to them. The children are afraid of asking any question as they are totally confused. They rote learn the text without understanding. And those children who cannot bear the burden of rote learning then ultimately drop out from the school. That is why it is recommended that second language should be introduced as a subject of instruction until the children are sufficiently familiar with it. Research has found that if children find their own festival, song and dance, folk stories, pictures, local fair, etc. in their textbook, as well as in learning teaching process, they find pleasure to learn because they can relate to it, they know about it beforehand, maybe it may be the same thing or slightly different, but they will be able to relate to it, which will make them take more interest and pleasure in learning. It creates a meaningful environment for children. But unfortunately, tribal children do not get such scope in our school systems. They have to read the textbook, which may not have content, concepts and examples from their locality and culture. So it is very important that the textbooks must contain examples and concepts to be taught to the children in the language that the tribal children are familiar with, and also taking on instances from the festivals they celebrate, the songs and dances of their culture and their tribe, the pictures of their local fairs and arts, for them to be meaningfully engaged in the teaching learning material. So let's look at some of the strategies for resolving pedagogical issues that the teacher may face. So using mother tongue as a medium of instruction, that is the first and the foremost and the most important as well. If unknown language is used, children would not understand anything that the teacher would say. For example, a Santali child in class 1 can understand Allah but not house, Merom, but not goat, which is the other word for goat, daka, but not rice. Though he or she can elaborate 5 to 10 sentences about his or her house, which he calls at Allah, in his or her mother tongue, but may not understand even one sentence about house in a language that is totally unknown to him or her. So, use of mother tongue or the home language as a medium of instruction not only makes the child understand the concept but also brings self-confidence, because if we say house and the child is not able to give another word or talk about it, we may say that the child does not know even about house, but the child has not been able to understand or comprehend what we are saying. So it is almost impossible for him to talk about it or elaborate on that. Integrating local knowledge in learning teaching process. No textbook can incorporate all the local knowledge from different areas of a state or a country, because as we know, we are a diverse country, so everything cannot be included. It is the role of a teacher who has to start with local knowledge to teach each concept and then link it up with the textbook knowledge. So the teacher should be familiarized with that local knowledge and should bring examples from the local stories, those dramas, pictures, local fairs, cultures and traditions of a particular tribe. And from those local knowledge, she should further form link with the textbook knowledge or the concept that she has to make the child understand. For example, if a teacher has to teach unit of measurement in mathematics, he or she has to start with the non-standard units first that are used in a day-to-day life, such as zero, manna, panna, etc., which the child is familiarized with. After that, he or she can teach the standard units that are used for measurement, like kilogram, kilometer, liter, etc. Using socio-cultural components in learning teaching process. Every community has its own lifestyle, own social values, socio-political organization, their religious beliefs, practices that they follow. They have their own food habits, the way they dress up, the way they use art ornaments, agriculture and industry. They have knowledge on every aspect of life. And this base knowledge needs to be taken into account to facilitate learning. Further, knowledge can be imparted based on the cultural elements already known to the child. We cannot make the child learn something which is totally unknown. We have to move from the known to the unknown. So in this diagram, you can see the socio-cultural components. So it talks about the different components that become part. So the food habits of a particular area, dress and ornaments, religious beliefs and practices that they follow, health and hygiene practices, values and social norms, professions and quality of life. Based on all these, from the different areas, the teachers can bring about examples from their day-to-day experiences and then link it up with the teaching that she has to do or the academic content that she has to transact in a particular classroom. So using folk materials in classroom learning, that is again very important. Every community has their own folk stories, songs, riddles, drawings and paintings, puzzles, etc. While facilitating learning, these materials may be used in their full potentials, because these materials not only facilitate for easy and meaningful acquisition of learning outcomes, but also make the learning process pleasurable. Adapting textbook with socio-cultural knowledge. So that is also very important. The textbook also need to be adapted to bring about the socio-cultural elements into it, and then preparing alternative texts wherever necessary for children's experiential learning. So all the things that we talked about in the previous slide through the socio-cultural components, those examples can be used in the textbooks for children to understand better and so that they are able to relate what is being taught to them. Learning of children's mother tongue by the teacher. So if a teacher knows the children's mother tongue, his or her job will be much more easier. Even though it is difficult to learn language of each child, but when a teacher has commitment, he or she can learn languages to talk with the children and community in their language. And the child will be much more comfortable in reaching out and approaching the teacher. the learning will be much easier, much more retentive. The teacher will be able to relate to the child. So in a way, it's advantages not only for the teacher, but also for the children. In both ways, it's a reciprocal relationship that will occur if the teacher knows the mother tongue of the children. Learning cultural knowledge from the community. The teacher has to also learn the knowledge of the child's community first. This is also very important. This can be possible when the teacher has interest to learn and identifies himself or herself with students' community. He or she has to talk with the community people, discuss with them on different socio-cultural milieus and attend festivals in the community. Once the teacher is familiarized with the cultural lores, folk tales, folklores, the festivals of a particular community, the rhymes, the songs that they have, why do they celebrate a particular festival and how is it celebrated. So this kind of cultural knowledge that she gathers for the community, she can use the same knowledge with children in the classroom, and the children will also be able to relate to all that knowledge that the teacher has collected from the community. This also builds the link between the community and the school, and it will help the teacher herself to reach out to every child in the classroom. Involving communities in school activities. A good teacher always uses the community resources. So community involvement in school management and classroom activities brings a positive change in the performance of children in the school. A community member can be involved to teach students local art and craft, songs and music, fables and stories, and other good practices of the community. So the teacher needs to meet the people of the community, identify people who use these kind of art, and they can be called to the classroom to share their cultural knowledge with the children. Thus, we can say that use of mother tongue as a medium of instruction in our learning teaching process will facilitate learning better now and in the future. So, what all can be done? Textbooks need to be prepared and translated in multiple languages. It is very important to have those textbooks in multiple languages because the children will be able to understand them better, relate to them better, and learning will be interesting, pleasurable for them, and it will be much more retentive. Multilingual dictionaries and glossaries need to be published, especially to cater to the needs of the tribal children. So, if there is one word, how that word, what is the alternate word for the same word in different languages? Such kind of multilingual dictionaries and glossaries need to be published. The socio-cultural context of tribals is unique, and in many cases having their own spoken languages. This emphasizes the need to develop curricula, instructional materials in tribal languages at the initial stages. Later, switching over to the regional languages that is used. So first, their own language, their own mother tongue is to be used, and then the regional language. The children, once they are good at their own mother tongue, then it will not be difficult for them to learn the second or the regional language that is part of the school culture. Emphasis should be on quality and equity rather than quantity, as has been the case in the past. So, the quality of teaching, the quality of the curriculum, the quality of the teaching learning material, and equity for all. That means every child is included. Their cultural knowledge should be considered valuable, and that will really help the classroom. In the tribal context, it is essential that the school schedule be prepared as per the local requirement rather than following a directive from the state. So in a particular tribal context, if they have a particular festival that they celebrate, so the school calendar should be such that they get an off on that particular day, which is relevant for them. So another holiday on which they do not have a particular festival would not mean important to them. Availability of locally relevant materials will not only facilitate faster learning, but also help children develop a sense of affiliation to school. So that interest that they will derive from coming to school, that affiliation, that feeling of connect with the teacher and also to the school will be only possible if the locally made materials, locally relevant material, their local knowledge in the form of local art and craft, stories, rhymes, their local songs and festivals. This kind of cultural knowledge is, unless made a part of the classroom, it is very difficult for the child to make a connect with the teaching that is taking place. So the teacher education also needs to change in order to implement procedural changes in classrooms suitable to the indigenous and tribal needs and aspirations. So the teacher training component has to become strong so that the teachers are trained how to deal with children with a classroom that has children from multilingual backgrounds, tribal children, how she can incorporate changes in her own teaching style so that she reaches out to every child in the classroom. Tribal area needs special education policy based on their own cultural and traditional life. So it is something which is relevant to their own context. May not be relevant to any other context. For them, it is the best adapted and best suitable. So there is a requirement for change in the policy as well. Finally, I would like to conclude by saying that skill development, competency building, and teachers' motivation need to be strengthened for sustaining educational development. The teacher should be made the center of the educational transformation and therefore must remain the primary facilitator. If she is a strong person who can communicate, who is able to understand each and every child's personal needs in his or her mother tongue, and she also uses community, she forms link with the community, calls the people from the community to use and to teach the cultural knowledge that they have, and she herself imbibes that cultural knowledge, it would not be difficult for her to give and transact that knowledge with the children in the classroom. And as we said, that once the child is comfortable learning from his or her mother tongue, that time, after that, there would be no issues in learning the regional, the second, or even the third language. So it is very important. So the teacher's role in this case is the paramount. She must remain the primary facilitator for transformation, educational transformation in the classroom, wherein she can form that link between the community and the students, which will be beneficial for the classroom and for herself to understand children in the best. Thank you.